Hi my beauties. Okay, so I'm gonna try filming this YouTube video just with my iPad in my house because I figure I haven't posted a video since before COVID, so in March sometime. And I feel like the reason why I don't post is because I don't have like a perfect camera or videographer. My audio is probably not great, but I wanna get the content out there. And if I don't film it this way and just kind of get the content out there to educate you guys, I'll never post it. So I feel that at the expense of not having the best camera and audio and film, I think that I'm just gonna post this as is. And if you guys don't like it, then I can kind of take that as a indication of if I should keep doing it this way or not. But just, you know, the majority of my day is spent treating patients and doing procedures in my office. And then when I'm not working, I have my two little ones. So it's kind of hard to just juggle. And I feel like I haven't posted in months. And a lot of my patients come in asking, when are you going to post? And so I wanted to just throw this out there, just this kind of ratchet, raw, unedited, not very professional video. Just giving you guys some content and education just to see if you guys like it. So a couple weeks ago, I asked you what you guys wanted to learn about or what you want to hear more about, and it was almost unanimous that you guys wanted to hear about periorbital rejuvenation. So periorbital just means around the eye, so that includes like the under eye area, the lateral crow's feet area, and like the upper eyelid area. Because there's a lot of different treatments out there. There's a lot of different topicals and eye serums and non-surgical and surgical procedures that you can do to enhance this area. And this is a really special area because it's the first to show our age usually, because that skin around the eye is very delicate and very prone to aging, because the slightest bit of collagen loss can cause that skin to be wrinkled or laxed or have those little fine lines and wrinkles, whether you're not expressing yourself or if you're smiling or being animated. So this is a really important area as well, because with wearing masks all day, this is usually just what people see. And so you want that to be an area that we're paying attention to, not only in our daily skincare regimens, you know, using eye serums, but also when we get procedures done too. So, I always break things down, surgical, non-surgical, and then with the non-surgical, treatments, there's injectables, there's lasers, there's energy-based devices, and then there's other forms of treatment like microneedling and things like that, which I'm actually not a big fan of, but I'll tell you why. So under the eye, there's a couple different things that can happen. We can lose collagen and elastin over the years. This starts in our 20s, not only from ultraviolet radiation, UV light, but just from, environmental pollutants and just chronological aging will break down collagen and break down elastin, and we lose about 10% of our collagen each decade. So when we lose collagen, the skin gets wrinkled, it gets laxed, and it lacks that smooth, tight look that we have when we're younger. And so different things that we can do include laser resurfacing, and under the umbrella of lasers, there's ablative, there's non-ablative, there's hybrids, and so I don't want to get into that too much. That would be its own video, but just doing laser resurfacing over the years will help stimulate collagen and help stimulate your body's own regenerative processes to keep that skin looking nice and young and tight and smooth and not laxed and wrinkle-free for the decades to come. Now, if you're older or you haven't been proactive in anti-aging and paying attention to this under eye area, it's not too late. We can also reverse the signs of aging and help tighten that skin, help reduce the fine lines and wrinkles by doing laser resurfacing, but it may take a little bit more aggressive treatments, and it may take a number, a higher number or frequency of treatment. So as opposed to someone who's in their 20s or 30s that want to keep that under eye area nice and tight, doing this once a year or once every other year, you'd probably want to do 3 or 4 treatments spaced 1 month apart to reverse that damage and kind of get you back on point. And then from then on out, it'd be like a yearly maintenance type of treatment to keep that under eye looking youthful and beautiful. So that's what we do for the under eye crepiness and wrinkles. The other phenomenon that can happen under the eyes is volume loss or a formation of the tear trough area. Now this can be anatomical, or this could happen with age, or it could be anatomical and get worse with age. So what happens is between the eyelid cheek junction, you want that to be a smooth transition. If you look at a child, like I always look at my little girl Riley, she's 6 years old, and I have a son Petey who's only 10, and they have a nice smooth transition between the eyelid cheek junction. Sometimes the fat pads underneath our skin separate and thin out and cause a tear trough, which gets accentuated with, advanced age and just sun damage and, wear and tear, and sometimes wearing masks can make it worse. And the way we fix that is by doing a little bit of tear trough filler. So what tear trough filler does is it kind of like smooths that eyelid cheek junction where there's a little divot or depressed line there, and it helps smooth that out. Now, sometimes in my younger patients, they could look like hollow or have like dark circles or blue kind of hues underneath the eye, and tear trough filler will help with that too. That's more of an anatomical thing. But for both cases, when you do a little bit of filler, and a little goes a long way, I'm super conservative, despite the fact that I'm a surgeon. Ask any of my patients, I'm very conservative, especially when it comes to tear trough filler, because a little goes a long way, and once you inject it, it expands in the tissue as well. Results last about 2 to 3 years, and it just gives you more awake and bright-eyed kind of look. It makes you look not so tired. Sometimes when you have like that sunken kind of hollow under the eye, you look tired, or sick, or you know, depressed and older. And so by doing a little bit of filler there, it just kind of shoots the eyes up and makes them look more vibrant and, you know, makes them look more bright-eyed. So that's filler. That's different than, you know, wrinkle and texture repair with lasers. So lasers are for wrinkles and laxity, and fillers more for volume loss, under eye tear troughs and hollows. So hopefully that makes sense. The other thing that I commonly do under the eye is V-beam. V-beam, V stands for vascular, and it's a vascular laser. It's a 595 nanometer wavelength laser that targets kind of the bluish discoloration under the eyes. Now, usually patients need 3 treatments spaced 1 month apart to get the best results, but I never sell packages. I never even propose packages to patients, because sometimes patients will respond to just one treatment. Sometimes people need 2. Some people need 3. Most people will need anywhere between 1 and 3. But I just like to manage expectations and tell you guys what to expect when you're having a laser treatment for under eye dark circles. And that's like that bluish purple kind of like hue that can look, make the eyes look like sunken or tired again, which is not from volume loss. That's just from underlying vasculature under the eye that kind of gives that bluish discoloration. So if you're a patient of mine and I see you in clinic and you want to kind of improve the under eye area, whether you have hollows, you have bags, you have wrinkles, whatever it is, I usually look at you and I examine the skin and see what treatment option would be best. And sometimes there's different treatments that will help target that area from different mechanisms of action. So it's kind of like when you have an infection and you take 4 different antibiotics to target that microorganism that's causing you to be sick, you'll respond a lot faster and quicker and more effectively than if you just take 1 antibiotic for a longer period of time. So if you have under eye changes, doing laser, a little bit of filler, you know, maybe even something to tighten like Thermage, which is an energy-based device, which I'll get to in a second. These all kind of like work together to help. Now, I don't want to overwhelm anybody viewing this video and saying, oh my gosh, I need all these things. It's not like you need it all now, but just it's good to inform you and educate you knowing what different treatment options are to target this area. So moving from the under eye treatment to the lateral eye. So this is called the crow's feet. When people smile and they get these wrinkles right here, that's usually from, you know, the muscle, which is, goes around the eye, called the orbicularis oculi. And Botox to help soften that gets injected here, here, and here. Usually to lift the brow that's under the eyebrow right here, the lateral tail of the brow. So I won't even get into that now because that's a different treatment, different video. But doing a little bit of crow's feet Botox right here will help smooth that out. And if you're younger and you want to be proactive, you could prevent crow's feet from happening there for many, many decades to come. And it's a safe area to treat. Now, usually patients who have under eye wrinkles, I don't recommend Botox in this area, because doing Botox in this area can cause an ectropion, which is when the eyelid doesn't touch the globe of the eye, or can change the shape of your eye. And with oculoplastics in the eyes, any like 1 millimeter difference between the eyes is very dramatic. And so you never want to mess with the eye or change the shape of the eye in any slightest way, because if 1 millimeter goes off, it just looks distorted and it looks weird. So I never do Botox under the eye. I used to in residency, you know, it was so funny. I remember there was a lecture. We had a whole didactic lecture for our residents at UCLA, and they were telling us, you never do Botox under the eye. So what did we do as residents? Allergan gave us some Botox to play around with. We injected each other under here, and we all came to lecture like the next day looking like this. And I learned my lesson. So when they tell us not to do something, we usually do it, and we mess ourselves up and our friends up, and then we never make that mistake again. So I never do Botox under the eye right here. But what's important to know about Botox for the crow's feet area, especially if it's your first time having Botox, and maybe you have some significant rhytids or wrinkles around this area, Botox is only going to smooth out this area. So what happens is when sometimes patients have lines under here and they have them radiating out from the lateral aspect, once you smooth these guys out, even if you don't change these at all, these become more apparent. Because when it's juxtaposed to smooth skin, people will be like, I have these wrinkles now, I didn't have them before. You usually had them before, but you didn't notice them because of these wrinkles. But when these are gone, these become more apparent. So oftentimes if patients come in and they've never had any treatments before and they have some significant wrinkles or rightets or sun damage or photo aging, I usually recommend doing a little bit of Botox here, but kind of under treating that area and then scheduling them for a fractal laser to kind of address those areas. So, and if you don't see me as a patient, just, I want to educate you and get you that information. So when you do see your provider, you're kind of informed and know what's going on, and you can ask him or her, hey, what are you going to do about this? Or do you recommend me doing Botox here? And what's that going to do to here? How's that going to change things? Because when we do Botox, it's all, you know, all these muscles in the face and neck, they're all antagonistic, protagonistic. If some get knocked out, the others sometimes can overcompensate. So it's important to have an injector that knows exactly how to strategically place the Botox so that your eye area looks like you. It just looks like a well-rested, beautiful version of you, but not any different. So moving on to the upper eyelid area. So a lot of my patients come in asking for brow lift. I love to do it. You can do it anywhere from 2 to 2.5 to 5. Some providers even do 9 units under the brow. It's always under the lateral brow to open up the eye. And a lot of people like that, you know, fox eye, all that, you know, the thread lift stuff. I do that too, but for this video, I'm just going to talk about doing a brow lift with Botox, because it's a very easy thing to do. It's not reversible, but if you don't like it, it only lasts 3 months. And you can usually it is reversible actually. If you do too much here, I can always do a little bit here to kind of like, balance it out and go the opposite way. I always leave myself some wiggle room when I'm doing Botox. And so you can ask any of my patients that, but usually I don't need to do it, but I always know how to kind of counteract an effect if a patient doesn't like it, which rarely happens, which is good. So I'm doing a little bit of Botox right here to lift up the brow is one thing we can do. Doing tightening devices like Thermage, or even doing resurfacing devices like Fraxel or any ablative or non-ablative laser. Some patients ask about CO2. I don't personally have a CO2 because it's an aggressive laser, and I usually get pretty equivocal results with a non-ablative Fraxel Restore, which is a non-ablative laser, but the outcomes are pretty similar in my experience to the two. You could do Halo, which is a hybrid ablative, non-ablative. There's lots of different lasers, and that's a whole different video. But usually the laser that I like for the periorbital rejuvenation is Fraxel Restore. And then usually if patients need a more aggressive treatment, instead of like hitting them hard with a crazy aggressive laser and having them bleed and have downtime, I just do baby steps with a less aggressive treatment, spaced again 1 month apart, about 3 treatments. It's like going to the gym and doing like the lighter free weights with more reps instead of like the heavy weights with just a few reps. So it's your successive approximations to a goal, but laser resurfacing for the upper eyelid does a great job of smoothing it out, so your eyeshadow goes on nice and smooth, it's nice and tight, and it's good to maintain it by doing it about once a year. So that was lasers, and now I want to talk about energy-based devices, which includes Thermage. Thermage is the device that I have, you know, doing a laser fellowship with a world-renowned laser expert and having every laser and device known to man in this two-story amazing laser institute. I kind of got to play with all these different energy-based devices and lasers, and that's how I decide which ones to have in my practice, because I have the ones that I noticed the biggest results, my patients loved, had the best results, and they were consistently would provide like the best outcomes and patient satisfaction out of all the other lasers or devices in that category. So when you talk about energy-based devices like Thermage uses radio frequency in the form of energy to put into the skin to stimulate collagen. Well, therapy does the same thing. It's not my favorite because I was a little bit underwhelmed, and my patients were as well with the results from microfocus ultrasound with therapy. However, a lot of my dermatology colleagues who are well-respected dermatologists in the field like therapy, so you know that a lot of people will say great things about it too. I just personally like Thermage better, and it never fails. Every time I do a Thermage around the eye, it tightens it up. Patients are very happy. Upper and lower lids are usually done at the same time. We need to put in a little eye shield to protect the globe of the eye during the treatment, but we put some numbing drops in. It's not uncomfortable, not painful. It's a little warm. It feels like you're getting a little eyelid massage. There's no downtime, and there's only one treatment needed. So I love doing periorbital Thermage, and even combining that with a Fraxel, again, going to the principle of a multifactorial mechanism of action to target one specific problem that you're trying to, improve. And I think doing a little bit of Fractional Thermage together, it like knocks it out of the park every time. So that's, and then Thermage has, like I said, no downtime, and the results take a couple months to really show, and they keep improving up to a year. And then the results last about 2 to 3 years, which is really, really nice. So Thermage, Fraxel, we talked about Botox, we talked about filler. Hopefully I'm not forgetting anything. I'll save thread lifts for another video, but yeah, doing thread lifts up here and a brow lift to kind of open up the eyes is another non-surgical, very quick and easy way to achieve almost like a brow lift result. And last but not least, there's surgery. So as a dermatologic surgeon, I'm very comfortable doing upper lid blepharoplasties. I don't do lower lid blepharoplasties, but I love doing upper lid. We do it in the office. It's an in-office procedure. It takes about 20 to 30 minutes. The downtime is not bad. A little bit of sutures in that get hidden in the crease of the eye. And that's for patients who are a little bit more, severe with the laxity, or what we call dermatocalasis, with a little bit of heaviness to their upper lids, that is not going to give you the results you want just with a non-surgical option like a Fraxel or an energy-based device like Thermage, or even Botox for that matter. So upper lid blepharoplasty is a very quick and easy procedure, and the downtime is about 1 week of a little bit of swelling and bruising, but the bruising actually looks kind of cool. It looks like you have like eyeshadow on, like it's not too bad with respect to the downtime. So again, that's more of the more severe cases that are a little bit more severe than any of these non-surgical options can be able to handle. So that's what all I can say off the top of my head on the fly about periorbital rejuvenation, and we'll just see if you guys like this video. Again, it's not the best quality, but I feel like if I don't get these videos out there, you guys are missing out on content and education, and that's what I live for. I love educating you guys. I'm super passionate about skincare, aesthetics, and dermatology, and I want to share that passion with you guys. And if I wait for like the perfect video, it's just never gonna be done. So my kids are playing Fortnite, we're about to go to bed, and it's a Sunday night, and the house seemed pretty quiet, so I'm like, let me just try this. So hopefully you guys like it. I will see you guys, and I'll hopefully get to as many questions that you guys post as I can. Love you guys.